So without further ado, I want to take the time to introduce our speaker. We have Mr. Demetrius Branca here from the Anthony Phoenix Branca Foundation. He's going to talk to you guys a little bit more about his story and distracted driving. So please give him a round of applause.
Good morning, Wolfpack. How you doing this morning? Wolfpack, how you doing this morning? Driving, but before I do that, I want to talk to you about my best friend in the whole world, my my best friend in the whole world, Anthony. Alright, so I'm going to make my way back up on stage. But while I do, I want to talk to you about this fresh face that you see right here. This is my best friend in the whole world, a young person who still to this day inspires me. He also happens to be my son, Anthony. And I was doing this presentation last week, and one of the young ladies in the back of the room said, "Hey, Anthony." And I was like, "That's my boy." One of the reasons why I love this picture so much, one of the reasons why this is such a great photograph, is because it's one of the few pictures, it's one of those few photographs that really captures a person's essence, captures a person's personality. It's one of those few pictures where you can kind of see who a person is just from a simple still portrait. It tells you something about Anthony. I have another picture that tells you something about Anthony. I'm going to tell you a little backstory for you to maybe fully understand what's going on here. You see, what we have here is obviously a beautiful family portrait. You can see Anthony up there in the corner. There's obviously a loving family. They love each other very much. They clearly care about Anthony, and Anthony cares about them. And the reason why that is so interesting is because the people in the picture are not actually Anthony's family. This is a family who jokes with me to this day that Anthony adopted them. But really what it was, is they loved Anthony so much that they just wanted him around all the time. Anthony had almost like a superpower. He could make any activity a fun activity, and that's why they loved him. So when it came time to do family portraits, they invited Anthony along. They made sure he wore a red shirt so that he would match the rest of the family. And that is how Anthony ended up in another family's beautiful family portrait. Also this one, and this one, also this one, and that one. Anthony ended up in all of their family portraits because they loved having him around. He was just such a positive force in their life. So, I want to tell you a little story because as his dad, I can relate to that. I can understand why they wanted him around so much. I can understand why when Anthony is around, they just loved having him around. So one day, I was cooking dinner, and I called Anthony down from his room where he was doing homework with his girlfriend Bella. And they came down to the room, they came down to the dining room, I came out of the kitchen, and this is what I found. So what I found was that Anthony had gone around the table, collected all of the seat cushions, put them on his chair, and sat on top of them. He was a little bit higher up than everyone else. He received the crown, and he proclaimed himself the king of dinner. Anthony proclaimed himself the king of dinner, and when I protested, I was like, "Anthony, do we really need a king of dinner?" He was like, "Silence! I'll bring you up before the royal courts for acts of sedition against the crown." And I was like, all right, I don't want to go to like royal prison or anything, so be the king of dinner, please." And when I did that, he took on the role of king of dinner he was just the best king of dinner. When I tell you, he was the best king of dinner, he made sure that everyone had equal access to the salt and pepper, he made sure everyone had access to the napkins, and he made sure everyone had as much as they needed to drink. He also made sure that we all had Parmesan cheese because I was serving his favorite spaghetti that night. So this is the king of dinner, and he was a righteous and a just king of dinner. Anthony had this spirit about him that was contagious. It was like when you were around him, things were just better. Things were just more fun whenever you were around Anthony. And he took that kind of spirit everywhere he went. So even when he was in school, even when he was at work, whatever he was doing, he was trying to make it a little bit more fun. He was trying to make it a little more entertaining, usually trying to make it a little more entertaining for himself. But in doing so, he made it entertaining for everyone who was around him. I will leave it up to you, however, to decide if it was appropriate for my son Anthony Branca, hashtag swag, to sign in late and miss first and third period for that particular reason right there. I hope you can read it. It says, Anthony Branca, hashtag swag, missed first through third period. The reason why, not because he's sick, but hashtag YOLO. By the way, I don't know that I've mentioned this yet. Anthony grew up in Tallahassee. This is a sign-in sheet from Leon High School, where he graduated high school. He had this spirit about him, about just taking on just anything and having a smile on his face as he did it. Now that attitude that he had that from a really young age. Anthony was in fourth grade, and we found out he was going to be a big brother. So one day I was talking to him about potentially, what we might name the baby, and I had kind of already decided that if the baby was a boy, I wanted the middle name of Orion, like the constellation. I thought that just was a cool middle name. So I was like, I think if it's a boy, it should be something Orion Branca. Well, as I was having this conversation with Anthony looked at me and he goes, Dad, you should name the baby Bob. I was like, Bob? You want to name the baby Bob? He's like, yeah, Bob. He's like, but Bob kind of sounds like an old dude name, not no. Hey, Bob. He's like, sorry. But Anthony wanted to name the baby Bob, and I was like, well, why Bob? So he's like, SpongeBob? And he's like, no, not SpongeBob, Bob. Because if you name the baby Bob, then his name will be Bob, and his initials will be Bob. And I was like, that's clever and funny, but we're not going to name the baby Bob. So at that moment, Anthony said, well, fine. If you're not going to use the name for the baby, I'm going to use it. Hi, my name is Bob. And he reached out his hand. I shook his hand. And I left. And I didn't think anything else of it. A couple days later, I got a phone call from one of his friends. And he was like, Mr. Branca, can Bob go to the movies? And I was like, Bob, Bob, Bob. I said, Bob? And he's like, yeah, Bob. And then it dawned on me, oh, he means Anthony. Okay. Anthony? Yes, Anthony can go to the movies. A couple of months later, I went to a parent-teacher conference, and the teacher was like, Bob is doing really well in math class. And I'm like, Bob. He fully committed to Bob. I mean, fully committed to Bob. Everyone thought his name was Bob. Everyone. Like, his friends were his friends' parents. Teachers, administrators, everyone thought his name was Bob. So in eighth grade, Bob was at Cobb Middle School. Bob was at Cobb Middle School, and he ran for student body president in eighth grade. This was Bob's campaign poster in eighth grade, and this was his video.
Anyway, hello, my name is Club that was called the Foam Sword Fighting Club. They only had one meeting and one
sanctioned sword fight. That was the end of that. But this breakdancing club, man, he was in that for a while, and he got pretty good at breakdancing. I want to show you a picture of him, this or a video of him. This is him practicing for a routine that the breakdance club was going to do at the pep rally the following weekend. Go ahead. Kids got some skills.
We're putting this dog poop on Mark's car.
Go in.
The only reason I wanted to show you that is because we haven't heard Anthony's voice yet. I wanted you to hear what he sounded like, and that's what he sounded like. What I also want to tell you about this is that Anthony and the young lady that you see in the photo there, that's Hannah, and their friend Mark, whose car they just pooped on, they were all involved in a prank war, and to this day, Hannah's Facebook birthday is wrong because Mark got in there and somehow changed it so often that now she has two birthdays, her real birthday and her Facebook birthday, and on Facebook she gets a whole bunch of happy birthdays on the wrong day because nobody knows that Mark Logan messed up her birthday, and that poop on his car was payback for messing up her birthday. So, before I go any further, before I show you the rest of this video, I want to set it up real quick. This is a video that Anthony had to submit for a class. It was an econ class, economics. I want to say it was his senior year. And the assignment was to talk about stocks and bonds and what if you had a bunch of money to invest. So this was an opportunity for Anthony to be a young business professional. So that's what he is doing here. Go ahead, let's see this.
Hi, I'm Anthony Branca. I just won the lottery. $25,000 in my pocket making me feel like a rich man. Look at this suit I bought. Alright, so, with my money, I'm going to avoid diversification because as a young business professional, I can't be wasting any time anywhere other than the stock market. I'm going to be placing $20,000 directly into high-risk stocks with a great increase and a great rate of return. I will be taking $5,000 and placing them in moderate risk mutual fund, just in the very, very slim chance that it doesn't all work out, which it will though, because I'm a business professional. Now, big money is not easy to get. Please observe this graph. You see right here, we got the big money right here in the stock. If you see how it takes up a big part of the graph, that says stock. And then over here, we've got the mutual fund, which takes up a pretty big chunk of this graph, but it's not as much as my stocks. And here we got a CD with a firm base because it doesn't make a lot of money. And I'm rich and I want to get richer, so I'm avoiding that. So, I being a young business professional and being champion of the lottery, I'm going to avoid diversification and go headfirst into a very risky venture of stocks in order to get a high rate of return.
He wanted to be a bajillionaire by the end of the week, and it was that kind of optimism, that kind of attitude that people just adore about Anthony. This idea that you can accomplish anything, that you can become a bajillionaire by the end of the week if you just invest properly. When Anthony was about 14, he got involved in Camp Indian Springs. Which is, for those of you who may not be familiar with Camp Indian Springs, it's down in McCullough County. It's an overnight summer camp where you can go for a week or two at a time during the summer, and you can swim in the swimming in the spring, and there's a blob in those cabins, and it's out in the woods. It's awesome. He loved it out there. And the owner of Camp Indian Springs, which is now called Camp Warrior, the owner of Camp Indian Springs is a gentleman named Derek. And Derek and Anthony became friends, and I have a video that I'm going to show you later on where that Derek's in. But right now I want to show you a video of a promotional video that Derek did. Right, so Derek was trying to get people to come to summer camp. He was trying to, you know, spread the word about Camp Indian Springs, and he wanted to make a promotional video, and the first person he thought of to help him make this promotional video was Anthony. And this is what they came up with.
Hey
now that we've flown into Anthony's mouth, go ahead and switch. Go on one. There we go. Okay. So I want to have a moment. I want to have a real talk moment with you guys. Real talk is a phrase that Anthony and I used because it was always life in our house was always fun. There's always something going on. And Anthony and I are constantly joking with each other. We're constantly having a good time. So we had to have a way of like stopping and saying, "Look, what I'm about to say is serious, and it's coming from a place of love." And so when I would stop and I'd be like, "Anthony, we need to have real talk. We need to have real talk." He would stop and he would listen to me, and he would do the same thing for me. He'd be like, "Dad, real talk." And then we would talk, right? So I want to have a real talk moment with you guys. Because what we're here to talk about today is distracted driving. So I want to explain what distracted driving is. Distracted driving is anything that takes your hands off the wheel, your eyes off the road, or your mind off of what you are doing, which is operating a heavy piece of machinery. So when you take your eyes off the road, or sorry, let's start with your hands. When you take your hands off the wheel, that means anything that takes your hand off the wheel, right? It makes sense. So ladies, when you're rummaging around in your purse, gentlemen, in the center console, or in your pocket, or on the floorboard, or if there's a puppy in the backseat, or a little kid, if you're moving your hands somewhere, you are distracted. Taking your eyes off the road, that also seems pretty common sense, right? If you're not looking at the road, how can you see what's coming? So, the moment you take your eyes off the road, you are distracted. You are no longer completely focused on the most important task at hand, which is getting yourself from point A to point B safely. And the third one is cognitive distraction. That means your brain, your attention is not focused on what you are doing, which is, of course, operating that heavy piece of machinery, that car. So we don't really think about that cognitive distraction too much. We don't really think about that because it doesn't really register with us. But a cognitive distraction is anything that takes your mind off of what you're doing. So it could be your phone, it could be your friends, it could be that sandwich, it could be coffee that's spilled in your lap, it could be anything that takes your brain off of what you're doing and puts it somewhere else. Right, so those are the three types of distraction. And what makes cell phones so dangerous is that they engage all three distractions, right? You are taking your eyes off the road to look at your phone. You are holding the phone in your hand. There's the first two. And your brain is focused on what you're doing instead of the road ahead, which is the third one. And that's what makes distracted driving so dangerous. And it's so dangerous, in fact, that the moment you engage in something on your phone, you are 23 times more likely to be involved in a fatal wreck or a wreck that involves serious bodily injury. Because the worst thing that can happen to you is not necessarily that you die. We don't think that it's going to be us that gets killed. But you may not get killed. What if you get paralyzed from the neck down? What if you have brain damage and you can't do the things that you're doing now? These are also real possible consequences. 23 times more likely that that's going to happen to you if you text while you drive. Part of what makes this so difficult, part of what makes this so difficult for us is that we're all humans. We're all humans, and humans have a really hard time wrapping our heads around our own death. We have a really hard time thinking about what it would be like to get into a wreck. We don't really know what that is. We don't really know what that feels like. Unless you've been in it, you just don't know. So what I want to do today is I want to take the bad stuff out. I want to take death out of the equation. Let's not talk about death. We're going to forget death for a minute. We're going to forget bodily injury for a minute. And we're going to say that the worst thing that could possibly happen to you is that you poop your pants. That's the worst thing that could possibly happen. All right, so what I'd like for you to do right now is join me on a little journey. All right, we're going to go on a journey into a fantasy land, a little fantasy world, where the worst thing that can happen to you is that you poop your pants, and if it's really bad, you have diarrhea. If it's really, really bad, it's explosive diarrhea. So that's where we're going. That's where we're going. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, please, if you will, close your eyes and follow me into a lovely world, lovely fantasy world, where everything is fine. Okay. Close your eyes. Here we go. All right, so it's early release Friday. Yeah, it's early release Friday. You've been talking to your best friend all day about what you guys are going to do that Friday afternoon and all Friday night. It's going to be so fun. You guys are going to have so much fun. Life is going to be great. You're thinking about that person that you really, really like who smiled at you today or wrote you a text today or sent you a snap today. You're all giddy and excited. Life is good. You're in the car with your best friend. You're leaving school. Everything is fun. Everything's exciting. Everything's fun. So you're in the car. You guys start going. You turn the music on. Music is feeling good. You're having a conversation. Is good. So you're driving along. Life is awesome. You see your best friend, that person that you love so much, in the driver's seat. You see them reach down and pick up their phone. Uh-oh. Don't you do it. Your best friend reaches down, picks up their phone. They put their thumb on the unlock button. You start to feel that rumbling in your stomach. You're not sure what's gonna happen? Bam! You poop your pants! Right there in the front seat of the car! You poop your pants! It's bad! It's explosive diarrhea! It's everywhere! Your pants are messed up! Oh my god, this is your favorite pair of jeans! Oh, it's on the seat! What are you gonna do? Did you bring a pair of jeans with you? Do you have wet wipes in the back seat? Oh my god! Oh my god! Think about how mad you would be at your friend! Think about how mad you would be! You'd be like, what are you doing? You made me poop my pants! Why? Don't you know that texting will make me poop my pants? Why did you make me poop my pants? You'd be so mad. You'd be like, don't ever do that again. Think about that. If the worst thing that could happen to you was that you pooped your pants from your friend or yourself distracted driving, none of us would ever do it. It doesn't matter how old you are, nobody likes pooping their pants. No way. Babies don't like it, even though they don't like it. Nobody likes pooping their pants. Now, the crazy part about all of this is that in the real world, you are 23 times more likely to get in a fatal car crash from distracted driving. You are 23 times more likely to be involved in a serious injury car crash from distracted driving. And we can't fathom the idea that it's going to be us. We can't think about it. That's not in our human nature to think, I'm going to die. And you're right. It may not be you. It could be your best friend. It could be your best friend that gets killed. It could be your best friend that ends up in a wheelchair. It could be your best friend that spends 6 months in a hospital recovering and never can walk again. It could be you. It could be your best friend. It could be someone that you don't know. It could be an old lady. It could be a baby. It could be anybody. Distracted driving doesn't discriminate. It happens, and it happened to Anthony. Distracted driving explains how we went from this beautiful, sunshiny, smiley face, this life, this person that embodied life, that is how we went from this picture to this. On November 7th of 2014, Anthony was on his way from work to school. Anthony had graduated from Leon High School soon before that. He had a job at a bagel shop and he was attending classes at TCC. His job at a bagel shop was right down there on Market Square. And one Friday morning, after his early shift at the bagel shop, he got on his motorcycle and he was headed towards classes at TCC. He was on Old Bainbridge Road, right near the I-10 overpass, and he slowed down to take a left turn. The vehicle behind him did not, because the driver of that vehicle was distracted by something. That vehicle hit Anthony going 45 miles an hour. How much of a chance do you think Anthony had? That vehicle, the driver of that vehicle, never touched his brakes. He never swerved, and after he hit Anthony, he coasted to a stop. All of these things are telltale signs that he was not paying attention to the road. Probably the first clue that he had that something went wrong is when he hit Anthony, because he wasn't even looking at the road. 23 times more likely that this occurs if you are driving distracted. That was not the only consequence of distracted driving. That was not the only thing that happened. What you see here are pictures of Anthony and Argos. Argos and Anthony were like long-lost wolf pack brothers. When we adopted Argos, it was like these two old friends had found each other, and they bonded immediately. Anthony loved Argos so much that he would take pictures and put them on Instagram. He would draw pictures and put those on Instagram. He loved his dog, and his dog loved him. In the weeks after Anthony died, Argos was confused and didn't know what happened. He was looking for his best friend. This is a picture of Argos just about a few weeks after Anthony was killed. What you see in the picture behind him, that door that's all scratched up, that is the door to Anthony's room. That's the door to Anthony's bedroom that Argos was just trying to get into because he couldn't find his best friend, and he was looking and he couldn't find him. All he wanted to do was find his best friend. This is a picture of Anthony with his two little brothers. His two little brothers who adored him, who thought he was the king of dinner and more. They thought the world of Anthony. The little boy up top is Isaac. The little boy down below, that's Christopher. This photo, the picture of Anthony and Christopher, is a photo that I printed on a canvas print for Anthony's mom in the weeks after Anthony was killed. The week after Anthony was killed, I bought this for her and I gave it to her. This photo printed on a canvas print and framed. What I didn't realize when I got that picture for Anthony's mom is that her son Christopher would hijack this picture. He took this picture and he put it in his little red wagon. So when he went outside to play, that picture and Anthony was with him. And when his mom asked him, he would be like, "I'm going out to play and Anthony's coming." When Christopher came inside to watch cartoons, this picture framed was on the couch with him. He took it out of his little red wagon and put it on the couch next to him. And he'd say, "I'm watching cartoons with Anthony." When he went to bed at night, when Christopher was asleep, this picture was hanging over his bed so that Anthony could be there with him while he slept. Anthony's friends were also really deeply affected. This is something someone wrote on Facebook. "Life is short." "You'll be missed more than you can possibly imagine." That's the truth. That is the absolute truth. He seemed to embody life itself, and I wasn't the only one who thought so. This was written by someone else, but it's true. Anthony embodied life itself, and it was so hard to understand where that life force was. Nobody could figure it out. Thank you for making me realize what's important in life. I miss you. I didn't write this, but I could have. I miss my best friend. I miss my best friend. Anthony was my best friend. He was a young man who felt more like a brother to me than a son. And I certainly miss his contagious optimism. Anthony had a way of making you feel like you can conquer the world. Even when you were depressed, he had a way of coaxing positivity out of you and making you feel like you were powerful, making you feel like you can do anything if you just set your mind to it, making you feel like the bad stuff that has happened to you, you can come out of that, you can rise above it. He believed that. So, when Anthony was killed, I was in a bad place. I was in a very dark place. I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. I wasn't sure that I wanted to do anything. It felt like life was bleak. It felt like life was gray, and I'm not sure I wanted to face all of that gray for the rest of my life. My best friend is gonna be gone. I'm never gonna have those kinds of conversations that I had with Anthony ever again. And it just felt like a huge weight was crushing me. I didn't know what to do. I wasn't sure how to go on, if I even could go on. So I started looking for clues. I started trying to figure out, well, what can I do? Is there something I can do? Do I even want to? What I didn't realize at that moment, because I was in such a fog, because I was so lost and I was just looking for my best friend, what I didn't realize is that the clues were there the whole time. The clues were right in front of me the whole time. And what I want to do now is I want to show you a video from Anthony's funeral. This is that gentleman I was telling you about, Derek. This is the guy who owns Camp Warrior and a really good friend of Anthony's. And I want you to listen to what he has to say about Anthony.
I've had the honor of being Anthony's mentor, his boss, and his friend, so I've known him in several roles, you know, over the past 6 years we've known each other. I first met Anthony through a volunteer community service group that I founded called the Outdoor Kids. The Outdoor Kids is a group that for teenagers that gets kids into simple, just going outside, camping, and then trains them for camp jobs. So I met Anthony. As soon as I met him, I knew there was something amazing about this kid. And before long, he had convinced me that he needed money to fix his Volvo, which he always needed to fix. So I hired him into a transport, and Tour Transport's a bus company in the music industry, so we provide buses for Rockstar. So Anthony would go on these random excursions with me. Sometimes we would get trapped places for like 2 weeks. We're trapped in Dallas once for 2 weeks. And we had to get this bus to Salt Lake City, and we're going to the Vans Warped Tour. And we had worked so hard, we had been up for 48 hours straight, and we drove straight all the way through the night. Anthony stayed with me the whole time, keeping me awake, keeping my eye on him. And when we got to the hotel in Salt Lake City, we pulled in, and we smelled this horrible smell. And we got out, and I accidentally flipped the switch on the bus. All the poo stays in this one area. And there's a switch on there for, you know, when you hook all things up right, it releases it all. And I accidentally hit it, and it was covered the entire bay of the bus. The van was, we were late. It was, and I looked at the video, and I was literally gagging, and like, my hands are on my head. I'm like, what do I do? And I turn around, and Anthony comes out, and he has paper towels in one hand, Windex, and he looks like a world with a bunch of holes in it. And, anyway, it was really funny because I was just gagging, and I can't remember exactly what he said. He said, we gotta do what we gotta do new. And he was cleaning it. Not only was he cleaning it, he was singing Willie Nelson songs. That was Willie Nelson's face. And he cleaned every bit of that. And then it was at that moment where I realized that Anthony could turn any, it's like we're talking about, he could turn anything into a fun activity. That was like his superpower. He could turn anything into a fun activity. That's definitely amazing feat. So I knew.
If you can turn cleaning poop into a fun activity, you have a superpower. And I wanna tell you that I think everyone in here has a superpower. So that was one of the clues that struck me after Anthony was killed about what needed to happen next. And I realized that what Derek relayed from Anthony was absolutely true. Sometimes we just gotta do what we gotta do. Even if it stinks. You gotta do what you gotta do. About 6 months after Anthony died, received another clue. This is a letter that was sent to his friend Chloe that she received from Anthony 6 months after he was dead. So let me explain how that happened. Anthony was given the task of writing a letter to an underclassman when he was a senior. He was a senior when he wrote this letter. And the friend that he wrote it to, Chloe, was a freshman. So I'd like to read this letter to you because I find it very enlightening. It says, "Dear Chloe, now you are a senior. You have your cap and gown. Hopefully by now you have decided what you are going to do. Whatever course of action you take, you have to go for it 100%. If you don't, there is no chance for success. However, You may not have decided yet. That's all right, too. Most seniors have no clue what they want to do when they graduate, but get on the ball, dog. Chloe, you're basically my little sister, and as a freshman, you were hella cool, but now you're grown up, and now you've got to take life by the balls and show him who's boss. Nothing is impossible. Impossible is a word used by the weak to justify giving up. Never give up. Clo-Clo, life is what you make of it. The question is not who will let you, but rather who will stop you. Your big brother forever, Anthony Branca. That letter was written to Chloe, but it may as well have been written to me because it told me exactly what I needed to do. It told me that I could never give up. It told me that giving up impossible, the word impossible is a word used by the weak to justify giving up, and I'm not giving up. A few months ago, a reporter came to my house. And we had a long conversation about the distracted driving laws in Florida. And he was asking me about the last legislative session and if I was disappointed that the distracted driving laws in the state have not changed. He was asking me if I was disappointed that Florida was one of only three or four states that doesn't have primary enforcement distracted driving laws, which means that a police officer can pull you over just by seeing you manipulating your phone while you're driving. In Florida, a police officer has to see you doing something else dangerous and illegal in order to pull you over, aside from just using your phone. So for example, if you're not wearing your seatbelt, if you are speeding, if you don't use your turn signal, if you do any number of other illegal activities, if a police officer sees you doing that and you're using your phone, they can pull you over and cite you for it. That reporter and I talked for a long time about what was gonna happen with the legislature and my efforts and what I'm doing. And he asked me, he said, it's gonna be really hard. Like, these politicians don't really wanna change this law. They're interested in other stuff. So it's not gonna happen in the next 5 years or 4 years. It's gonna be impossible. You're never gonna be able to change it. At the end of that conversation, he asked me why I do what I do. At the end of that conversation, he asked me, Demetrius, why do you go to high schools and talk to high school students? Why do you go to colleges and talk to college students? Why do you go to churches and civic groups and talk to people? Why do you spend so much time at the Capitol trying to convince politicians to change the law? Why do you do all of this stuff? And my answer to him was real simple. My answer to him was this. My best friend was killed. My brother was killed. My son was killed. If it had been the other way around, if it had been me who had been killed by something so senseless, something so pointless, something so preventable, Anthony would have been mad. Anthony would have raged. Anthony would have started a war. He would have started a revolution because this is not okay. This is not okay. Your life is worth way more than a text message. Anthony's life was worth way more than whatever that person was doing on their phone. There's nothing that person could do on their phone that was worth Anthony's life. Anything that person was doing on their phone that was that important, he should have pulled over to do it safely because he did not, and it cost Anthony his life. And if it was me, Anthony would be mad. Anthony would start a revolution, and he would say, this is not okay. And that's why I'm here today. I want you to help me, because I can't do it by myself. It's gonna take an army of people, it's gonna take a bandana army of people to stand up and say, this is not okay, my life is worth more than text messages, Snapchats, and Instagram put together times 10, times a bajillion. My life is worth more. All of us need to stand up and say that. And we need to talk to our friends and say, your life is worth more. I love you, real talk. Your life is worth more. Please, put your phone down. It means being a good passenger. It means when you have a friend who picks up their phone while they're driving, you can say to them, hold up, let me be king of the playlist. Hold up, let me be designated texter. You can say that to your friend. And if it sounds difficult, if it sounds like something you don't want to do, remember, sometimes we got to do what we got to do. Especially for those that we love. Especially for those that we care about. We've got to do what we got to do. And if it feels like it's going to be hard, if it feels like, no, I can't do that, I can't tell my friends how to live, Nothing is impossible. Impossible is a word used by the weak to justify giving up. Don't give up, because your life and their life is worth more. It is worth more than whatever they are doing on their phone. This is a revolution, and the revolution has to start with each one of us individually, making the decision to put our phones down when we drive. And I beg you, I ask you, please commit to this. Commit to this idea. Commit to it like you're changing your name to Bob. Commit to it. Make everything that you do about this. You're going to be safer. You're going to be smarter. You're going to put your phone down when you drive. You're going to make sure your friends put their phones down when they drive, because your life is worth more. There are a lot of people here today, and there's a lot of people in their classrooms today watching this. And each and every one of you has potential to change the world. Whether you believe it or not, each one of you can change the world. Never, ever underestimate the power that one single person can have to change the world. Never underestimate that. You can be that person. You just gotta commit. Commit like your name is Bob. You have unlimited potential. There are people in this room who are going to go out into the world after you graduate, and you're going to do incredible things. I already know this. I believe in that. I hope you do too. I hope you believe that nothing is impossible. I hope you believe that you can have an impact, whether it's a positive impact like Anthony had. Anthony was the person who walked into a room and made sure that everyone else was in a good mood. He made sure that he brought positivity with him wherever he went. You can be that kind of change, or you can be the kind of change that killed Anthony. You can be the kind of negativity that killed Anthony. You have the power inside. It's your choice. It's your choice. You get to decide, am I going to be a positive influence on the world, or am I going to change the world for the negative? And I hope you choose positive, because there's unlimited potential in this room. The things that you can accomplish in the people in this room is unreal. It's beyond what we can even imagine right now. It's beyond that. We don't even know what's going to happen. So as you leave here today, as you go out back to your classes, leave school this afternoon, and then go off into the world after you graduate, I hope you carry this message with you. I hope you carry Anthony's spirit with you, because we need it now more than ever. We need it now more than ever. There's a lot of problems in this world that need to be fixed. There's a lot of negativity that needs to be overcome with positivity. And that's where I hope you come in. I hope you become the person who's contagiously optimistic. I hope you become the person who brings positivity to their friends. I hope you become the person that saves your life and your friend's life just by doing what you gotta do. And remember, nothing is impossible. Impossible is a word used by the weak to justify giving up. Never, ever give up. You guys are wolves. Wolves! Never give up. This is our contact information. We have a Snapchat now too. I just haven't fixed this slide. Sorry, that wasn't supposed to happen just yet. I hope you enjoyed my stories about Anthony. I hope you take something with you from this. But I want to open up the floor to any questions that you have. Does anyone have any questions? Can't see. No, nobody. Room full of people and no questions. Yes. What happened to the driver that killed Anthony? Thank you for asking that question. It's a really good question. It's probably on a few people's minds. The laws in the state of Florida are written such that killing someone while driving distracted resulted for this person in losing their driver's license for 6 months and paying an $1,100 fine. That's it. That is the value that the state of Florida places on your lives. 6 month suspension and $1,100 fine. Nothing on that person's phone was worth Anthony's life, and Anthony's life is certainly worth more than that. I hope that offends you. You should be mad at that. You should be mad when you see someone texting and driving, or even using their phone and driving. Because what I forgot to tell you a few minutes ago, or maybe I did, is that just using your phone, just manipulating your phone has the same effect on a driver as being over the legal limit for blood alcohol. Just using your phone makes you drive like a drunk driver. And we all know how bad that is. We've been told that our whole lives. So I hope you get upset. I hope you're offended when you see someone driving. And if it's your mom or your dad who's driving distracted, I hope you have a conversation with them. And remind them that you love them. Remind them that their life is worth more. Any other questions? Anyone else have a question? Did that answer your question okay? Anyone else have any questions? The guy, what was his name? The guy, you want to know the guy who killed Anthony? I don't want to say his name. His name isn't important. Anyone else? Anyone else have anything? Okay, yes, ma'am. Why was he not charged with something heavier? It's just, look, I went down to the district attorney's office and I spoke to the district attorney about that because when I found out that they were charging him with careless driving, I was mad. That was my best friend. I was mad. And it turns out that that's just the way the law is written. And in order to change that, in order to have distracted drivers be charged with something more serious, we have to change the law. And that's what I'm doing. And as a matter of fact, yesterday, the House of Representatives filed a bill for this coming session that is hopefully going to make distracted driving a primary offense, which is a huge, huge deal. Yes, back there in the back. Yes, ma'am. Yes, tissue donation. Thank you for bringing that up. Anthony, when he got his driver's license, he checked the box that says, do you want to be an organ and tissue donor? And so he went, after his wreck, the EMTs came rushing in and they tried to save him and they couldn't, but their efforts allowed Anthony to be a tissue and organ. He didn't donate organs. He was allowed to donate tissue. And his tissues have saved at least 69 people, if not more. So there's a little boy somewhere in Arizona or Nevada who had Anthony's heart valve. And there's a gentleman somewhere in Carolina who has a piece of Anthony in his neck, which is what allows him to, it allowed him to get his neck fused, and it allowed him to live a full life again. He could start walking and golfing and fishing again. And there's stories like that all over the country. I get letters, random letters occasionally, about things that have happened because Anthony was an organ and tissue donor. While I'm here, I may as well encourage you, when you get your driver's license, if you haven't done so already, make sure that you're an organ and tissue donor, because you can be heroic even after you're dead by donating your organs and tissues and saving someone else's life. Thank you for that question. That's a great question. I think we are just about out of time. I'm going to hand this over to Melissa, and thank you so much for giving me your attention. You guys are awesome. Thank you.